How many times have we come to a point where you have that prompting that you're supposed to do something for a man of God, that you're supposed to do something to someone, but you're holding on to it and saying, no, I'm not sure, you know. I love one thing that mommy saying some time back, that the devil can never push you to give. Hallelujah. Whenever you get a prompting to give, it's for your own good. It's for your own dominion. It's for your own salvation. Hallelujah. So, when it comes to honoring, there are protocols. There are protocols in honor. So the protocols of honor are in three verses according to what I teach today. So the first, you see, the first protocol is to recognize the man of God. Hallelujah. Yeah. Recognize the man of God. In verse 9, we see that the woman recognized the man of God. For she says, this man is a holy man. How many men of God have you recognized in your life? Hallelujah. At times, it's not just the pastor that ministers to you in your local church. Because you can see that in the book of Genesis, I think it's chapter 4. By the time Abraham was sitting at a tent, Abraham was visited by angels. Hallelujah. If he did not have the spirit of discernment to serve these people, to honor these angels, he would not have received the message that he received. Because it was at this point that he was told that he was going to have a son. Yes. Hallelujah. Amen. So the place of honor gives you message, reveals to you something that you would ordinarily want to come across. The place of honor puts you in a position, positions you. Like for example, if I say I want to receive sunlight. If you look around, there's no sunlight here. But I have to sit at a place where there is no obstruction for the sunlight to reach me. Yeah. Is it true? Yeah. So the place of honor puts you, positions you in a place where you are receiving the beautification in your season. Hallelujah. Yeah. So when you recognize a man of God in your life, what happens? What happens when you recognize a man of God in your life? You come to a place of understanding. Hallelujah.
Amen.
You come to a place of understanding. Because from my testimony, meeting God's servant, I've come to a place where I've learned things that I would normally not have learned, if I may use the word. I've been taught to pray differently from how I used to pray. Hallelujah. Making reference to verse 9 still, about what this woman said, I was so moved by what this woman said that it got me thinking, how many times do we take for granted the people that God has put in our life? How many times do we overlook that which the simple things they do, but the simple in, according to our thinking? Am I making sense?
Yes.
The simple things according to our thinking. Because in our thought, in my thought, I would say, okay, the God servant came to my house and prayed with thank God. This man sacrificed his time. This man sacrificed his resources to come to you. This man sacrificed time with probably his family. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
And this man is showing, or this woman is showing love to you by the very virtue of him ministering to you. We get to see that these are not simple things. These are not things that someone would just come out of the blues to do it. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
And in my life personally, the person that I call my spiritual father, I've seen this real time to a point that I think some time back I asked him, why do you do the things you do? Hallelujah.
Yeah.
I try to understand it, knowing how he does things and how he approaches things. There are times when, I don't want to say we fought, I was rained on. Hallelujah.
Amen.
There are times that I've been rained on and you look at the call and you're like, oh God, now which question am I going to ask? You know? I don't know, Oliver, I think you can relate. You get to a place and you're asking, okay, if I don't answer this call, it's a problem. If I answer it, it's a problem. So you're thinking like, okay, what's the way out here? Hello? You don't have an answer. I don't know. Okay, I think you should be in that place one time then. We can share. Hallelujah.
Amen.
But it doesn't change the fact that I have recognized him as a man of God in my life. Hallelujah. Amen. It doesn't change the fact that despite everything that I may think is hard, and everything that I may think is putting me in a place of hardship, it doesn't change that I recognize that this is a man of God, because the grace that is working in his life, the grace that I'm serving in his life, the purpose that I'm serving in his life remains unchanged until God says so.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
And from what I've seen, that has not wavered a single second since I started following you. So you get to a point where you understand. The second thing we look at, I'm just giving us the titles, then we'll go through them again. The second protocol you get to see is, once you recognize the man, bless the man of God. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Paying keen attention, I'm saying, bless the man of God, not just the man. The man of God. And in this context, I'm not just using man to mean the masculine gender. Maybe a female servant, for those who are listening. That is, this is just general, to mean the servant of God. So bless the man of God. What does it mean to bless the man of God? There is, I don't think there's something we could give to the man of God that will change their lives. That is something I'm convinced about. Someone who's truly called by God, there is nothing you can ever give to change their life. Because one, the Bible tells us, touch not my anointing and do them no harm. So it means by the time they're in that position, there is an anointing that they're working with that is different from what we understand. It's different from what we see. It's different from what we have experienced. Hallelujah. So I can't say that the offering that I'm giving, if truly this is a man of God, the offering that I'm giving is not for the man of God. It's my service to God. Hallelujah. Am I making sense?
Yes.
The service that I'm giving is not for the man of God to buy popsicle. It's not for the man of God to buy candy or to get something for his family. It is my service to God. I'm giving because I understand the ministry of giving. I'm giving because I understand that if I get to this point of giving, that I'm giving to God and it's not to the man of God. Hallelujah. Oftentimes we forget that by the time we are honoring the man of God, we are not honoring the person. We are honoring the spirit that is working in the person that God has put in the person.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
So this is something that you ordinarily won't understand unless you recognize and discern. Hallelujah.
Amen.
And the third thing is, receive blessings through the man of God. Receive blessings through the man of God. For the little scripture that I've read, I've not seen someone who's received a blessing that has not come from a man. Hallelujah. Okay, the blessing does not come from a man. The blessings come through a man. Hallelujah. I'll make a good example. Rather, let's use the example of Jesus. Jesus, we are told and I'm convinced that this is the Son of God. Hallelujah. So if Jesus wanted to have a ministry, he could have easily done it by himself. But Jesus chose men. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Jesus chose men. Have you ever wondered why you're told that God is all powerful, God is all big, but still, he chooses to work with men? Why? Anyone with an answer to that? Random. Anyone with an answer to that? Why does God choose to work with men? Because God can. It really is all powerful. The earth belongs to him. He can do with the earth whatever he wants. The earth is his footstool. Is it?
Yeah.
Told, the scripture tells us that the earth is his footstool. So, why does God work with men? Why does God bless people through men? understanding that I don't need to go to church. The anointing for understanding some of the things that are scriptural has not been given to you, has been given to the men and women. They're told that many are called, but few are chosen. So if you're not among the chosen, then it means you're supposed to be following the chosen. You're supposed to be listening after the chosen. Hallelujah.
Amen.
For our understanding, I guess, to see that these are aspects that are in place. So, how can someone be sure that the man that they're listening to or the man that they're following is a man of God in the midst? I'll speak about three ways, three keys for you to look for. He's anointed to lead God's people and does God's work. Hallelujah.
Amen.
How do I know that this man is a man of God? Someone may ask, okay, this woman had a different spirit to be sung. What should I look out for? What should I look out for? He is anointed to lead God's people and does God's work. From the few years that I've lived, I've seen a different man of God that I know, a different man of God. But they have different ways in which they do things. And some of these things, it's not until late in my life that I came to realize that these people, in as much as they were doing things, but they were not doing things according to the scripture. For example, someone may say, I want to pray for you, but they are putting their legs on you. Why in scripture do you see that Christ put their legs on someone? Hallelujah. Where did we see that Christ asked for someone to pay up when they were prayed for and they were healed? Unless I've missed it, someone who's seen that in the scriptures, please show me. We're told that freely you receive, freely you shall give. Hallelujah. Freely you receive, freely you shall give. The gifts that we have, we do not pay God. We do not ask God, God, I'm giving you this 100,000, give me the spirit of him. Who did that? It comes from God because you are the chosen. Hallelujah.
Yes.
So, how do I know that this is a man of God? First, the anointing will manifest. Hallelujah.
Amen.
The anointing in their lives will manifest. And you know by how they're doing it, how they're doing God's work. I made a reference, or I gave an example. I say that at times I wonder why God's servant will take his time to come and speak to you. Like, just pick a call and call me. How are you doing? You know? Like, how was your day? At times I have conversations with him and I'm, okay, I laugh not because, not because that I don't want him to call, but because at times I fail to comprehend why is he like this? Every time he called, yes, I know there is the love factor. I know there is the love bit in it, but of all the people that he knows at this particular time, why did he call me? Why did he choose to know how my day was? You know, there's some questions you're asked and you're like, okay, you look around, has he sent something around me? You know, has he sent something around me? I don't know if it's just me, but at times I see the call and I'm like, okay, I'm in your home. God bless you, sir. So the second thing you should look out for, he does not compromise the word of God to please men. Hallelujah.
Amen.
The book of Joshua chapter 1 verse 8 says, choose ye today who will serve. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Choose ye today who will serve. But as for me and my family, we shall serve the Lord. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So the man of God does not compromise, does not dilute the word to fit what you want. He gives you the word as it is. Hallelujah. He walks, the third thing, he walks in God's love to serve, edify, and sacrifice for his flock. Hallelujah.
Amen.
The man of God walks in God's love. Now there is a whole definition. This is, I think it would be a whole series we start talking about God's love. To understand God's love, it's so big. that it is beyond our comprehension. The love of God is so big that it's beyond our comprehension. But you're told, for you to understand, or for you to know that this is truly a man of God, he walks in God's love to serve, edify, and sacrifice for his flock. Hallelujah. So if you're only on the giving end and not on the receiving end from the man of God in your ministry, I'm not saying he's not called, but I'm asking you to think twice. Hallelujah.
Amen.
If you're always the one giving, you're not receiving, then there is something. Okay, from the man that I follow, I receive.
Mm.
I don't know about you.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
From the man that I follow, I receive. As much as I think I receive more than I give. I think I receive more than I give. If I'm being honest, I think I receive more than I give. But at times I tell you, no. But he says, okay, this is for you. I'll get there, son. I'll meet you at that. Yeah, so I've mentioned protocols about recognizing the man of God, about honoring. I said that I was mentioning them briefly, then we'll come to them. Now, if you're looking at the first thing that I mentioned about the protocols of honor, what was the first one?
Recognize the man of God.
The second one?
Bless the man of God.
The third one?
Receive blessings from the man of God.
Amen. Now, let's look at the first one, recognizing the man of God. Verse 9. She said to her husband, I know that this man who often comes our way is the holy man of God. So making reference, I started with explaining what we should look out for to know that this is a man of God, so that you may understand what I'm going to say next. So for you to know this is a man of God, we're supposed to look at those three things that I've mentioned. So in verse 9 she said to her husband, I know that this man who often comes our way is a holy man of God. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
We must pay very particular attention that what the scripture says about men of God. Or rather, let me ask a question. How many of us know what the scripture says about men of God? How many of us know what the scripture says about who a servant of God should be? Okay, then why are you following? This is a question. Why are you honoring if you do not know what the Bible says about them? Why are you honoring? A question. Because the scripture, like I've just explained and said, we should know by them walking in God's love to serve, edify, and sacrifice for his flock. So for you to have followed something, okay, let me give this example. Hi, Grace. How are you?
Hi,
Iki. But she's also Grace. Why did she respond the first time? That's how you've known her. How did you know her?
That's what we decided when she came to us, that she would be called a
killer. No, I don't think that's the case. You see, I would have easily said, if someone else would have called, say, Grace, the two of you would have turned. Is it true? Someone, a total stranger would have turned. But because I call you Grace and I call her a key, that's the difference. So you see, when it comes to honoring is like a trigger. I don't know if I'm making sense.
Yes, yes.
Honoring is like a trigger. When you honor, it means a trigger is something like, the way I've said Grace, you responded and she did not respond. But I said the key, she responded and she did not respond. So the trigger is not in how I call her, but it's in who called her. It is the same way with men of God. It is not about the person, but it's about the spirit in them.
Amen.
Am I making sense?
Yes.
It is about what you see in them that has triggered you to follow.
Amen.
You're not following because they are handsome, you're not following because they are tall. I'm not saying that our man of God is not handsome. I'm not saying that. He is very handsome by God's grace. Hallelujah.
Amen.
We are following because of there's a trigger that is making you to follow this particular man. There is a trigger within you that is making you to honor this man.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
I need us to understand that by the time you decide to honor for the beauty, It is a trigger. There's a trigger. There's something that is triggering you to want. And there is that trigger in him that will make him pray a blessing over you. And that blessing is what you're calling the beauty of God. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So this woman saw. She saw the man of God, and to a point that this man asked, what should I do for you? Hallelujah. There is something that prompted the man Elisha, if I may use the word. Something prompted the man Elisha within him to say, what should I do for you? This woman was blessed. She had the things that as humans would say, this person is blessed. But this woman was lacking something within herself. She lacked a son. And by the time she honored, the reward came from the prophecy. If you read that scripture, God's servant, Elisha did not pray. She prophesied. He prophesied. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Sometimes you do not need a man of God to pray for you for your beautification. By the time you honor the man, he needs to speak a prophecy upon your life for your beautification. Hallelujah.
Amen.
The second thing is, bless the man of God. You see, I'm still making reference to the same text that we read. From verse 8 to 10, it seems as if this woman was someone that was well known. Hallelujah. So she blessed the man of God with what she had. So maybe you may be there and saying, okay, I may not be in the capacity to build and furnish a house for the man of God. But there is something you can do from where you are. Hallelujah. There's something that you can do that will prompt the prophecy from the man of God upon your life. There is something that you can do that will trigger that prophecy to come out. There's something that you do. There's a way that you love the man of God that by the time he is in his hour of prayer, he mentions you in his prayer. She mentions you in her prayer. Hallelujah. So what is that thing that you're using to bless the man of God? What is it that you are having in mind to bless the man of God? And the third thing we talked about is receiving blessings through the man of God. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Receiving blessings through the man of God. If you make a reference to Abraham and Lot, Abraham was blessed, was a blessed man. From the scriptures, you get to see that this is the first man that God gets into a covenant with. Hallelujah.
Amen.
God gets into a covenant with him to bless him. But remember, by the time Abraham was being blessed, there's something that came. The blessing was not just for Abraham. God, in Genesis, God told Abraham that, I will bless those who bless you, and I will curse those who curse you. Hallelujah. And you get to see this when we have his cousin Lot with him. So if you read the scripture, it's not that Abraham was blessed. And because of the blessing that was upon Abraham, and by the virtue of Lot being with Abraham, the blessing overflowed. I can use the word. Overflow. I did not go through schools like some of us. So we get to see that the blessing of Abraham was not just for him. It was also for those around him. Hallelujah. It is the same thing with the blessings that are upon the life of God's servant in our midst. So by the time you are receiving the blessings of the man of God, you get to understand that this is where the beauty comes in. So we need to get to a place of understanding that, according to what I'm talking today, one of the ways among the many ways that we'll be talking about during this desire, one of the ways that your life can be beautified is through honoring the man of God. Hallelujah. So my encouragement to us is, as we engage, or as we plug in for this year's Zion, as we say and be beautified, there are those elements that you need to pay keen attention to. There are those aspects that you need to understand, that if I'm going to be beautified, then I need to do ABCD. And one of the ABCDs, or The A in this case is honor. Hallelujah. You need to honor for your beauty by the grace of God. And I believe we shall be blessed in the name of Jesus. So let's kindly be on our feet. Let's kindly be on our feet. Let's just one. Let's just take grace. Take grace to understand. Take grace to believe that by the time I'm honoring the man of God, my life shall be beautiful. May God's grace. Father, in the name of Jesus, we bless your name. We take grace, King of Kings, that as we plant about honoring King of Kings, we shall give us the grace to honor the men and women in our lives for our beauty, King of Kings. That as we honor them, mighty Father, our lives will be transformed. Our lives will be lifted from one level of glory to the other. As we see and as we anchor our prayers on what you did to the Shunammite woman, King of Kings, as we honor them, Lord, our lives will be beautified. All for the glory and honor of your name. In the name of Jesus Christ, we've given thanks.
Amen.
Let's put our hands together for the Lord.
Are you blessed?
Yes.
Are you exalted?
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
What a word in the name of Jesus Christ. We are focusing shortly by the grace of God as we keep on writing today on the word of God. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Proposes the entrance of the word, give a light and give an understanding to the bullet. Now, Acts number 20 was that to say, I commend you the word of his grace that is able to build you up. Then give you what? An inheritance. Amen. And I pray by the grace of God, but before the end of these sessions, before the end of this week, truly you shall be visited. Truly you shall be have an inheritance in your life in the name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
The word that has been recommended to you will build you up.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus Christ. I love what Brother Henry has said. Discernment. Amen. Honoring is just as simple as discernment. That, I don't know what was your highlight. For me, that simplicity of the word, it is discernment. You cannot honor unless you discern. When the Bible says honor thy father and mother, it means you have discerned that's your father and that's your mother. Amen.
Amen.
For you to honor the Lord, it means you have recognized that is your God.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
And getting with the story from the book of 2 Kings chapter 4 from verse 6 to 17, whatever she shared, the woman was a notable woman. So it doesn't matter, then no matter the level of blessing in your life, if you have discernment, you always walk with honor.
Yes.
So you can't honor to be blessed, you only honor because you are blessed, amen.
Yes.
It's only that it has not yet manifested, amen.
Yes.
So it doesn't matter, even if you are flying with jets, you still honor, amen.
Yes.
One powerful testimony we used to hear, when I used to go to realize something like that, most people who are CEOs of companies, they were saying, oh, straight. They are pastors, amen.
Yes.
Why? They honor the Lord. They discern the name of the Lord. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
And the protocols of honor have been shown to. Is it true?
Yes.
I've been told you must recognize. You cannot honor who you don't recognize. Amen.
Yes.
If you recognize someone in your life, you will honor them.
Yeah.
Why most people say, I shall walk out to my own salvation, fear and trembling, and they don't go far, it's because they misuse the place of honor. They don't understand honor can unlock doors for you. There's a realm of the spiritual capacity you can never get by yourself. You need a man who has gone ahead of you, who you would want to take you there.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah.
You need a man. The man was at a beautiful girl for 38 years. He said I had no man. Is it true?
Yeah.
So you need a man. The Ethiopian eunuch was a man who feared the Lord. He read the word by himself. Is it true?
Yeah.
By the place of honor, he told the young man, Stephen, jump up. Is it true?
Yes.
Let me hear from you. Is it true? He could have said, I'm a man of high regard. How do you come to my chariot? Amen?
Mm-hmm.
He has some 4 horsepower. Amen?
Mm-hmm.
Why are you coming through? The man was already on a chariot, so he was not a poor person. But honor made him access to the depthness of the word of God. So honor is very critical, but recognize who to honor.
Yeah.
Failure to recognize you may remain at the same level.
Yeah.
Amen?
Yeah.
Recognize. Do you recognize who you honor? Ask a neighbor, who do you honor in your life? Who? Yeah. Hallelujah. Or do you honor Unga Ugali? Amen. Amen. What do you honor? You must, there's somebody you must honor in your life. Amen.
Amen.
And he says, when you honor the one of God, you are blessed. You bless them. Is it true?
Amen.
How do you bless someone? By how you pray for them. How you talk about them. How you think about them. But every time you see a phone call, like my son, thank God, he debates if to pick or not to pick. By out of honor, you see pick. Amen.
Yeah.
Even if rain will come with thunderstorm and lightning, amen.
Yeah.
He
you will still pick the phone call. Hallelujah.
Amen.
But it's a place of honor. You know, one thing most of us need to understand that men of God are not normal people at the end of the day. They may come raining on you. You understand? If you lack understanding, the devil can talk you out of them. Honor is the only thing that can keep you. You imagine about Peter. Peter who told Jesus, no one will crucify you. Then Jesus turned around and said, you devil, get down behind me. Amen. Satan. What do we call him? Satan. Amen. I know Peter looked and said, am I Satan? Amen. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
But it took honor for that man to stand, the last man standing until the cook came. Am I saying the truth?
Yeah.
It took honor. Imagine someone calls you Satan. Would you say that? You Satan, get down behind me. But see, he was not talking to Peter. He was talking about the spiritual man behind Peter. The man had understanding that the father and my father, the faith, is not trying to rebuke me for faults. Most people leave church because of offense. And when you carry offense because you lack honor. Most people have their problems with their biological parents is because there's no honor. You're talking about? I always say, even if your father is a witch doctor, he's still your father. Amen.
Yeah.
How did you get on that? He threw him. Is it true?
Yeah.
So honor him. Amen.
Amen.
And honor him. You bless them by your conversation, by your
yes.
thoughts about them. Amen.
Amen.
You pray for them.
Amen.
Amen. That woman had capacity to build a house. May you have capacity to build a place in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Capacity. I always say, if your man of God is not handsome, it means the children in the church are ugly. Amen.
Yes.
If all of them are handsome, the man must be handsome. Amen. So you dress your man as where you're going. Amen. You take care of your man as where you are
going.
Any beautiful church has beautiful people.
Yes, yes.
You know what I'm talking about? Any constructed church has people who have construction. If you are raised by sons who are so selfish, they want to go with that and hunger. You understand?
Yeah.
You know, generally, even the scriptures, when they wrote the tithes are supposed to be given to men of God.
Yeah.
Because that's how they should survive. You understand? Men of God survive from tithes and offering. So assuming you're dealing with men who are stingy, the man of God will fast and pray for 120 days. Or for how many? 360 days. Is it true?
Yeah.
Hallelujah. The man will not be able to deliver. Because why will we fast? Because the men there don't honor. Amen.
Yeah.
If we still see the church in West Africa doing very well, it's because those people have been taught honor. You say, Pastor, yeah, the boy is blessed like this. We should wear the boys because the men know to honor the men.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah.
And look at the flow of grace now. They duplicate what their fathers are doing. Because what honor attracts virtue. And that's the last point to talk to receive. I will talk about receive in terms of multiply and operating as the way they operate. You know what I'm talking about? Multiply and operating as the way they
operate.
Now, David said, through thy law, thou hast made me wiser than my teachers. I meditate on the word of God, thou hast made me wiser than my
teachers.
So there's the capacity for you to do far better than a man of God is possible. But it starts by honoring. When you honor, virtue flows. The Bible says in the book of Psalms 193 is like oil from the head of Aaron down to his skirts. So when you honor, you draw virtue. You draw oil. If he carries oil of gladness, you become double. If he carries the oil of wealth, you have double. If he carries the oil of multiplication, you carry double. That's what it came out. Honor is not triggers. You have someone says they pray the name of their father in the faith and something happened. You're talking about? They realize, oh, sister, as I follow him, I have divine wisdom. The way I see things is very different. Because you start behaving like him. Amen? Elisha came at the water of Jordan and said, after the order of his father, Elijah, oh God of Elijah. And he smiled at Jordan, his father. Is it true? And the men of that side, they said, the spirit of Elijah does rest upon him. Why? Honor to it. So receiving not only the blessing material, which is good, a man of God should bless his people, should take care of his people, you know what I'm talking about, is very important. You know what I'm talking about? But also receive the spiritual fat you carry. Amen.
Mm-hmm.
There's something you draw when you honor. When you realize something is not working on you, you stop honoring the man of God. You're just physically, but your heart has run. And that's what happens to most of us. After some time, we get used to grace. We say, nah, holy lands, what is doing it? As far as we minister, there are men of God I honor in my life. That I listen to, that I desire to be a blessing to. One day I'm even believing to take some of my people to them. You're talking about? Why? Because they carry virtue. I said desire may they, man. He said, not only that, they may not be your pastor. You're talking about? It may be someone by discernment. You must have discernment. That they went for ordination for my father father-in-law, and one man of God came. My wife was not sitting with me, she was sitting like two rows ahead. She turned around, I told her, I know what you're thinking. Amen. I said, where is the money? Pack it, offer it. No small money. Amen. Hallelujah. You don't give a man of God thousand or 10,000. Amen. That man has more than whatever it takes. If you want to grow much, you give as it is. The Bible says, if you give sparingly, you receive what?
Sparingly.
If you give bountifully, you receive what? So the bounty of grace is dropped by bounty giving. Mm-hmm. You know?
Yeah.
It will not release you, and we just say, pack it now, now, now. We just look at each other. We knew what it was, discernment. Truly, this is a man of God. And when we told the facts of a man of God, they walk by the word of God. They are ruled by the word of God. They walk by the love of God. Is it true? And I just want to show you a final scripture, the book of 2 Timothy. When you see yourself or power being used, it means you honor well. When men are stopped being used in a particular environment, it means their honor is departing. When you honor, God will use you. When you honor, men of God will bless you and use you. So it's not slavery, it means there's detection of value in your life. Amen. How many times was Elisha sent? They start to the point and say, why are you being used? You're being misused by the man of God. No! It was honor that was in the place of Elisha. That's why he was being used. Brother, we pray. The day you don't see my phone calls, you start praying. You say, what's happening? With my honor going? Amen. When phone calls are not coming, it means there's something in you that is going. And God will not allow you to stay around them because you know you will destroy them. How many times were they called Judas? Judas is only called for the accounts. There's not a place where God that Judas was called. Amen. But Peter, everywhere. Amen. The signs of Zebedee were everywhere. You think about why? Because their honor was intact. We're talking about John the Beloved. Is it true? He was born in awe for the sake of Christ. In absence and in presence, honor was there. Amen. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 19 to 21. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 19 to 21. And I pray by the grace of God, may this desire jump into you in Jesus' mighty name.
Amen.
Amen. The Bible says very well, 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 19 to 21. Nevertheless, the foundation of God standeth what? Sure. Are you there?
Yeah.
2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 19 to 21. Nevertheless, the foundation of God standeth what?
Sure.
Standeth sure. Amen. Amen. Having this, this is that the Lord knoweth them that are what? So God knows you. God knows when you belong to Him. Amen. And the Bible says, and let everyone that nameth the name of Christ depart from what?
Iniquity.
Amen. Amen. And verse 20. But in a great house, they are what? They are not only vessels of what? Gold. And of what? Silver. But also of wood and of?
Clay.
You are talking about? And some to what?
Honor.
And some to what?
Honor.
So where do you want to fall in? Do you want to be gold or do you want to be clay? Which one do you want to be? And look at this, verse 21. If a man therefore purge himself from this, he shall be a vessel of what?
Honor.
Sanctified. And meet for the master's use. And prepared unto every good work. People who honor are used. People who honor are prepared for the good work ahead.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
How often are you being used? Is a reflection of the honor you carry in your life. If it is heavy for a man to call you, it means you love him. A parent only calls a child who honors him. Do you know that? Am I saying the truth? Yeah. So if you are close once with the man of God, and that's your story once upon a time, then what happened to your honor? What happened to your what?
Honor.
It means you move from a mentor from the importance of God to earth. Do you want to be that level?
No.
No. You know something about? And you are meant for the master's use to every good work. That's what honor does. Relevance. Honor brings relevance to an individual. When you don't become relevant, it means your honor left. I said, I don't call that one. That one is always on motion. Amen. That one is a prayer point. Before we locate you, we need to track you. Because no honor. Amen. Honor unlocks doors. But I bless God for me. In this family, I have children who honor me. Amen. And I pray for the grace of God, you shall be used for the good work. Amen. You shall open doors. Amen. And I pray for greater grace in the name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Why are you blessed by that word? Why are you blessed? Will you pursue honor for beautification?
Yes.
Don't ever feel, never get tired of serving or honoring. Because you never know the hour for your lottery. You never know. You never know. Be committed. Stay dedicated. Even if you have food or no food, continue at it. Amen. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
Continue at it. The Lord has seen it in secret, one day will reward you openly. The Bible says, if you are faithful in another man's business, God will give you your own.
Yes.
Amen. So honor is what guarantees you have your own. Most of us have to have our own things. But when you have been put in charge, do you honor the assignment you have been given? Hallelujah.
Amen.
Because as I'm doing enough, you say, Father, I take grace to walk in honor. In the name of Jesus, just open your mouth and start praying up here. Father, I take grace. I take grace to walk in honor in the name of Jesus. Bashoko Bara. Lord God of heaven, I take grace to walk in honor. I take grace to walk in honor. In the name of Jesus, Ramayoto Zokoraba. Nakaparato Sobreketereba. Lebrekoto Zoko Pragaraba. Lord, I take grace. I take grace in the name of Jesus. I take grace in the name of Jesus. Lord, from today, as for Lord, I shall not be found wanting, Lord. I shall honor my way out. I shall be beautified. In the name of Jesus, Rabarashokoto Reba. Latese Kratuze. Eprakatosoko Praketeze Karada. Ezenterebaratosoko Prekatazia. Zemteretosokotose Katalara. Zemfratusokoba. Letesenterebratusokoto Rebara. Lord God of heaven. Lord God of heaven, in the name of Jesus Christ. Rashutozo Paragaraba. Esekatosokotososo Paradaraba. Lord, I take rest to walk in honor. I take rest in the name of Jesus Christ. In Jesus' man's name. Father, I pray, let us all partake the grace to walk in honor. Give us a good heart and a good mind. In Jesus' man's name. Amen. Put your hands together for Jesus' name.